Welcome everyone. Today I want to talk about another stemsock build. And last time what I did was a full bow character, so a bow on both bars. This time it's a full dual wield. You could also use dual wield and two-handed, for example. Just it was supposed to be a full melee build, because the thing, I really still like the full bow, and I can still swap to this build with this character. I basically just swapped the weapons and some skills. There's a lot of things I liked about that, and the damage was actually about the same as this one. Of course, you have the standard variation of dual wield and bow. So yeah, you can always swap to that, but here I just want to do full dual wield. And the main reason for this was What I missed in the bow build is Hurricane, because it's just such a signature skill of Stemsocks, and the damage is not that bad, to be honest. It's pretty good damage. And yeah, what I like about this build is you have these two auras, so the Hurricane and Deadly Cloak, and you can just jump in and damage everything around you. And the cool thing about these two is also that they are both offensive and defensive. So Hurricane deals a lot of damage, but also increases your resistances and movement speed, while Deadly Cloak deals some okay damage. It's not great, but also decreases the damage from AoE you receive. And this is obviously pretty nice. If you're full melee, you don't have to dodge everything. And yeah, I guess let's just talk about the build. I will go over the skills first. Because skills are just the most important part of a build, I guess. Like, or the they are the signature of a build, and then everything else is built around that. Let's say it like this. So on the front bar, we have Crushing Weapon from the Sigic Order. Yeah, I tested. You can also use, of course, Rapid Strikes. Deals a little less damage than Crushing Weapon in total, and it's harder to weave in light attacks. And yeah, if you're using Reliquance Weapon, then it's really important to get in as many light attacks as possible, as quickly as possible. So their Crushing Weapon is definitely the better choice. You also get some more, even more survivability. So this build is extremely high survivability. You will see why. So here we have 25% lifesteal, and this thing can crit. And it's your main damage skill, so you will heal all the time. Then we have Rending Slashes. It's just a dual wield damage over time. The other morph heals you for a bit, but honestly, we already have so much shields, not really needed. Then again, the damage increase from this morph is also not that high, so you can as well, maybe for PvP it would be even better to have even more heal. You could also just use the heal morph, whatever. But yeah, you definitely want this dual wield damage over time. Then Beast Trap, Rearming Trap, and this definitely Rearming Trap. For the bow build, I would have recommended the Lightweight Beast Trap, which that morph does that you can place it further away, I think up to 28 meters or something like that, or 18 meters. You got the Rearming Trap, you place it in front of you, deals physical damage. Oh, this is by the way also important. This skill deals physical damage, physical damage, physical damage. So everything right here is physical. And yeah, this one deals damage instantly, then deals some damage over time, also grants you minor force, increasing critical damage done. The other morph, this morph, Rearming Trap, makes it so that when the trap expires after 6 seconds, it rearms itself once, so it lasts twice as long, deals not twice, not two times the amount of damage. It deals a little bit less on the second time. Anyway, Critical Surge, also one of the signature skills of any sorcerer, actually. So yeah, you gain major brutality. I definitely want to have that. And you also When dealing a critical strike, you heal yourself for almost 3000 health. Bound Armaments is from the, sorry, from the summoning line. Yeah, Bound Armaments just passively increases your max stamina by 8%, which is really good, and light attack damage by 11%, which light attack damage by 11% is really good because light attack damage is actually in the top two of our damage dealt. I'm not sure right now if it's top one or top two. Yeah, what Bound Armament also does is it activates Daedric Protection, increase your health and stamina recovery by 20% while you have a Daedric summoning ability slotted, and this is the only one I use here. So really, we do this also for the 20% stamina recovery. Okay, yeah, on the as the ultimate, this is the front bar is where we spend most of the time while dealing damage. And we don't really use the Flawless Dawnbreaker ulti, but it just it grants 5% weapon damage while slotted. This is the unlocked at level 10 from the Fighter's Guild. Yeah, and the Morph does that it increases weapon damage by 5% while slotted, and it gives another 3% here from the passive of the Fighter's Guild. Okay, back bar. As I said again, dual wield. Yeah, usually, let's just say, usually you would use a bow here because then you can use caltrops and rain of arrows, or how it's called, endless hail. Extremely strong ability. But yeah, we cannot do this here. Instead of the endless hail, I use deadly cloak. Basically, that's like literally the only weapon skill right here. Also, the ultimate with the bow build, we used ballista. Here, we use rend instead, which is again nice for the melee portion because this thing deals the damage is okay. It's I think about the same as actually the bow. The bow ulti deals more damage in really short time span. But this thing deals, yeah, a little less damage, but also heals you for 50% of the damage done. So, and I mean, there's one more thing. There's a passive. Increases the damage with dual wield abilities by 20% against enemies with under 25% health. So this definitely benefits from this. It's also rather cheap ultimate. Yeah, then we use sorry, where is it? Ah, here. Yeah, Assault skill line, you unlock that or you level that by doing PvP in Cyrodiil or in the battlegrounds as well. It takes a while to unlock. Also, you want to have Vigor, resolving Vigor. Just another heal. It's not absolutely necessary because we already have so much, but if you want to do Maelstrom for some harder dungeons, just so you can keep yourself alive, basically. It's a really nice stamina-based heal. Now, yeah, Razor Caltrops, insanely good skill. It has a great radius of 8 meters, duration 12 seconds. If you don't have access to Razor Caltrops, you can, for example, use, where is it? The Undaunted Guild, you can use Shadow Silk. Yeah, Shadow Silk is just another AoE. It slows enemies and deals a lot of damage. So it's pretty similar to Razor Caltrops, it's just worse. I mean, I actually tried using Shadow Silk on top just by replacing it with Vigor, or replacing Vigor with Shadow Silk. It's not a bad idea, but the thing is just it's a really expensive skill, and it didn't do that much. Now, Shadow Silk is an incredibly strong skill if you look at the synergy. The synergy, so you basically after 5 seconds you deal 8,000 something damage, or at least with my stats right now. But then if someone activates the synergy, it deals another 10,000 poison damage, and then another over 15 seconds, There are spiders attacking for 1800 physical damage with light attacks, basically. So you, I don't know if that's another 15,000, 20,000 damage over time, and then, because of the morph, there's another chance to deal 19,000 poison damage over 10 seconds. So incredibly strong. The problem is, I thought this was the perfect skill, like underrated skill, because it's also like it deals so much damage and it's a synergy. So this would be really nice for your tanks, so that your tanks can activate the synergy and regain some stamina or whatever. Problem is, it says a ranged ally targeting an enemy inside the webs can activate the Black Widow synergy. And ranged means, I think, 28 meters or, yeah, or 20 meters, something like that. To be honest, I'm not sure. I looked it up and it was really disappointing because people said usually the maximum range is about 15 to 18 meters where people stand, so nobody will ever activate that synergy. So that's why I don't really like this skill. Anyway, if you don't have Razor Caltrops yet, you can definitely use Shadow Silk. You could also use simply Steel Tornado. It's a great AoE skill. Like, we don't have in this build, in this variation right here, we don't have any spammable AoE. The thing is, we have 1, 2, 3. Yeah, we have 3 AoE damage over time, which is usually enough. And then we also have another one from the monster set. So yeah, usually stuff just dies anyway. And this stuff here also deals damage to single target enemies. That's why I prefer it. So you can just place these on the boss and you can use them both in single target and multi-target environments. While if you're using Steel Tornado, you don't really want to spam this against a single target. Doesn't make any sense, so you're wasting a slot. Anyway, if you are not having Vigor or Caltrops, just use whatever you want from these options here. Alright, so yeah, then we have on the last slot again, we have Bound Armaments. I want to have it on both bars. And Resolving Vigor. This is like a flex slot, you can use this for whatever. Anyway, this is the build. Now for items. Monster set. I tried a few ones like Krax. Krax gives you increased physical penetration, which is really nice, especially against the target dummy. Yeah, but here the 124 stamina recovery just helps. Just seems to be more beneficial. And also the shock damage and physical damage here is really nice. These are the main damage types of sorcerers. As we can see in the passives, like here, where is it? Energize increases your physical and shock damage by 5%. As you have seen, almost all our damage, I think in fact, this is physical damage, this is physical damage, this is physical damage, this is physical damage, yeah, every single skill we use to deal damage is physical damage, so yeah. If you ask yourself why do people play stamina sorcs, this is one of the reasons. Another reason is when you deal shock damage or physical damage, you have this implosion effect. Only works at low life, so enemies under 15% health. Doesn't happen that often, but when it happens, you can deal like 10,000 damage for free with a 6% proc chance. And since everything we do is either physical or shock damage, and this set as well, this happens quite sometimes, especially when the enemies have like 6 million health, so at 15% they still have like about 1 million left. That's plenty of time to proc some of these implosions. Okay, to the next set. Like, I have Reliquance here and you will think, oh no, not this set again. To be honest, I'm not the biggest fan of this set anymore. I don't know if I will use it on a dummy afterwards. But yeah, it's obviously the strongest single target set. First of all, you gain the Mane of Slayer, 5% extra damage to dungeon and trial monsters. And of course the 5-piece effect You apply a stack of harmful winds. You can apply up to 20 stacks with light attacks on a single target, and it will just be among one of your biggest damage sources, more or less for free. The big problem with this set is you cannot switch targets. And in some fights, this is really not optimal. Sometimes you just have to, you want or you have to kill some adds, and then your damage really starts to drop because you are not applying. Every time you are under 10 stacks, you are kind of losing damage. Or maybe, I mean, 10 is still good, but if you're constantly switching targets, and this build is not really for dealing with huge, we don't have the spammable AoE, as I said. So yeah, you kind of, okay, but first, I'm using Reliquance sometimes. For the second set, we have Spriggans. Simply for the physical penetration, it's really amazing. Like, do not underrate this set, the amount of physical penetration, and also stamina. Like, the stamina looks bad at first. There are sets which give much more weapon damage, for example, but then you can count 1058 maximum stamina as about 100 weapon damage, so you could convert this into about 324 weapon damage, which is not that bad anymore. Okay, yeah, on the second bar, of course, you could also use the Spriggans as well. I don't have the Spriggans daggers because I actually used, for some time, I used, the bow as well. So then I always had the set effect up. Now on the back bar, it's not that bad. You can just, I just used whatever. I still had some daggers of Hunding's Rage. You can use these, you can use any daggers you want, basically. Optimally, you would like to golden out your weapons, of course. Yeah, that's that. So now let's talk about some alternatives. So for the monster set, I would definitely recommend Krak. You can use Selene's. Yeah, there's a lot of options for just some nice physical damage. And still, Stormfist is just fits extremely well for Stemsorg, just not to use it. So Reliquant here, what I use is actually Automaten. Oh yeah, Automaten adds 386 weapon damage to your physical damage abilities, which is, as you have seen, every single ability that we use. Okay, except the heals. So Hunding's Rage, for example, would improve our heals more, which is one. It's the resolving vigor, but anything else, Automaten gives us more damage. Yeah, you can use Hunding's Rage if you don't have access to Automaten, for example, and to Reliquin, you can just, yeah, use Hunding's Rage. You can use, okay, I'm not too sure about many more options here. I mean, for PvP, no, I honestly just recommend Jailbreaker for light armor builds. What else is there? Yeah, I'm not too sure. I mean, you could use probably Slots or something for PvP as well. But these are the three sets for, obviously, instead of Spriggan's set, you could obviously use the Vicious, no, how is it called? Let's see, trial sets, and then medium. Sorry for that. Twice Fanged Serpent, yeah, of course. Because here, when you deal damage, your physical penetration is increased by 860% 860 for 3 seconds, stacking up to 5 times. So this gives you over 4,000 penetration. Also, instead of 2 times stamina, you get 1 weapon crit bonus, which is also a plus. So yeah, this is definitely better than Spriggans for PvE. Because it really takes 1 second or so, because you have all these AoEs and dots running, so to deal damage really doesn't take long. It doesn't take 1 second for you to deal damage. So you instantly get up to 5 stacks here, and yeah, it's really good. Oh, I think we forgot something. So your stats, obviously. The health is a little bit, I mean, people say 17,000 is minimum, but since this build, Like, Stemsorg just has so much self-heal. Like, I could honestly even go below that. So I did, the other day, I did Fanglare on Veteran, and it was no problem staying alive. But yeah, still, you're usually looking to get around 17,000. Now, we are putting all the points into stamina. To be honest, it doesn't really matter. You could also spend some into stamina, some into health to get into this. What I'm doing is, I have health glyphs in my helmet and shoulders. So that's how I get a little bit. And then, of course, you cannot forget the food. I mean, don't look at food as if it's some luxury item. It is ne absolutely necessary for every build. For every single build you have, the food is a is like another passive. So here you get Dubious Cameron Frown. This is the one I would recommend. Increases stamina recovery, maximum stamina, and maximum health. And it says maximum health by 3,500. But if you have some passives that increase health by, let's say, 10%, this bonus from the food also gets increased by 10%. The same goes for stamina and stamina recovery as well. So, for example, these 319 stamina recovery. Right now I'm at 2,000. Oh, that's a little bit high, to be honest. Yeah, that's way too high. One reason why this is too high is because I have an infused necklace with stamina recovery. It's like way too much. Okay, but yeah, I'm getting off a little bit here on the, like, this is, I'm still working on the build, but the general idea is here. I think 2,000 stamina recovery is probably a little bit too much, so I could actually use some food, maybe some food without stamina recovery, then I would be around 1,500. Okay, quick look at the stats. Weapon damage is 2,500. Crit is 53%. Now this is without major brutality. No, wait, what's it called? Major savagery. We don't have that. Usually, I'm a big fan of the Hunter passive here from the Fighter skill because it just gives you 10% crit chance. So usually I use this on the last slot here. Here we don't have that, and that's why you also kind of need to use these potions. I crafted these myself. I didn't even buy them, or did I? But yeah, these don't give a major brutality. They just give major savagery, and then they restore health and stamina. Now what you can see is potions have a 45-second cooldown. But these potions last for 47.6 seconds. Now this is an advantage of crafted potions because they last longer and they last that long, like longer than the cooldown because of medicinal use. You can see I leveled alchemy to 50, or yeah, to 50, so I can craft the potions, but I also leveled it up so I can use the medicinal use. When using potions, the resulting effects last 30% longer. Yeah. Okay, I guess we will talk about some of the passives really quick here. Reduces the magic and stamina costs of your abilities by 5% from the ma so the magic, these are really all of these sorcerer passives are really beneficial. Reduces cost of stamina abilities by 5%, that's what we want. When you hit an enemy with a dark magic ability, you heal for, okay, this actually doesn't make any sense. Yeah, okay. This is basically the only important one here. I mean, the others are nice to have, but unholy knowledge is what you want. Here, you really, I mean, and that examining is kind of strange. You need to level it up all the way. It's easy to level it up because Summon Atronach is a crazy good ultimate, actually. I mean, you could even use it if you want. Your personal DPS will drop if you use this instead of Rend. On the other hand, sorry. On the other hand, this has a really strong synergy, and also just by slotting it, you will increase your damage by 2%, your weapon damage by 2%. Anyway, for the passives, reduces the cost of your ultimate abilities by 15%. And we already talked about data protection, 20% increased stamina recovery. Storm calling. This one is absolutely crazy. We also use the most skills from here. We use Hurricane and Critical Surge. Yeah, you could, for example, another suggestion for the flex spot here. If you don't like Vigor or you don't have Vigor, you could, for example, use this teleport ability. I'm not really sure what to do with this, but since we don't have a gap closer, this is probably a really nice option for PvP. Also in PvP, you probably wouldn't use Razor Caltrops because it's a placed on the ground damage, which you don't really benefit from in PvP because people just run around. So yeah, I would probably in PvP replace Razor Caltrops with Bolt Escape. So we still have the Vigor heal. Anyway, to the passives of this tree, increase your magicka recovery by 10%, yeah, whatever, take it anyway. Increase your physical and shock damage by 5%, this is crazy. Implosion, we already talked about this. And Expert Mage, increase your weapon and spell damage by 2% for each sorcery ability slotted. So we get 4% because here we have Bound Armaments and Hurricane, and here we also get 4% because we have Bound Armaments and Critical Surge. Now, for the weapons, oh yeah, this is one benefit of this build. You need extremely little skill points, because if you don't skill anything into bow or into two-handed or whatever, if you only need to go dual wield, you have so many skill points left. You can go into the guilds and even into crafting. You can definitely do at least two crafting jobs or even three if you want, if you only use dual wield. But then again, you probably also wanna experiment with the bow a little bit if you're new. Okay, sorry, I'm always drifting away. Dual wield passives, I mean, I will not read them out all day, you just take them all. They are all extremely good. Medium armor, same, you don't really need improved sneak. Yeah, but it's just fun, honestly. All the other ones are really good, but you need to have 5 or more pieces of medium armor. That's important, because this increases your weapon damage by 12%. Here we have sprint and dodge are heavily reduced in cost. We have some extreme crit bonus. We have, this is probably the most important one, increases stamina recovery by a lot and reduces the stamina costs. So both of these together are extremely strong. Then, yeah, armor, I mean, we are using one or two pieces of heavy armor. I think I'm actually using two. So this increases your maximum health. So this way you can push your health a little bit and your resistances. Light armor I don't use at all at the moment. Then in the Undaunted, so the reason why people always say 5-1-1, so 5 of your main armor and 1-1 of the other ones, is because of this passive right here. For each different type of armor you're wearing, you get one, or in the maximum, if it's maxed, you get 2% increased health, stamina, and magicka, which is really strong. Don't underestimate that. So yeah, but right now I prefer to run two heavy pieces just you get some more resistances. But it doesn't really matter. Okay, did I forget anything? Race, yeah. For the bow build, I mean, it's still the same character. Red God was a little bit sad because this adrenaline rush didn't work at all, because it only says when you deal damage with the melee attack, you restore 792 stamina. Doesn't work at all with bows. But yeah, here it does, so I would really recommend Red God for this, because every single one of the passives is perfect. Perfect, it always works. More stamina recovery, more stamina, and even more stamina recovery, basically. Now, Khajiit is also nice, because they get 8 or 10% crit chance, I think, for weapons. And yeah, I really like Khajiit. Problem I have with Khajiit is that they have a sneak passive, which doesn't do anything in normal combat. So they have one passive that's useless, and that's probably why Red Guard is better overall in such a melee build. You could also use like the thing I would use for the bow build is wood elf, and it kind of struck me at that point when I realized that. But yeah, wood elves are for full bow user probably the best race because they have huge stamina recovery. But then again, they also have this useless sneak passive, useless for combat at least, if we are not talking about PvP. So yeah, I would say Red Guard, but then again, anything. You could probably even use an Orc. Increased healing received, so yeah, even more unkillable than Orc. Yeah, actually Orc might be nice. You get 4% increased melee damage, and since all the damage you do is melee, that would be pretty funny. You also sprint faster as an Orc, so yeah, I kinda like the thought of that. Anyway, I think we covered almost everything. We covered food, potions, oh yeah, vampire. I mean, being a vampire is kinda optional. I really just use this for the 10% increased stamina recovery, but it's not that big of a deal. And, of course, if you want to have a... This is actually a red guard, you know. So if you want to have a white-looking red guard, you should become a vampire as well. So I kinda like that. The only thing is, I absolutely hate how the eyes look. Like, the eyes in stage 3 vampirism are horrible, so that's why I'm using this accessoire. Yeah, let's talk about champion points. Of course, for this build to work, like for all the stats to work out like they do here, you need at least 300 champion points, because if you put 300 points into... if you put 100 points into one of into these red things combined, you get 20% increased maximum health. The same goes for blue and green. So 100 points into blue, so any blue combined, means 20% more magicka, 20% more stamina. 20% more stamina means you also deal more damage, because stamina is directly transferred into an equivalent of weapon damage, let's say it like this. As I said before, 1000 stamina is about 100 weapon damage in your skill tooltips. Okay, the champion points themselves, I like to boost Ironclad a lot. Reduces damage taken against direct damage attacks. So it would be nice to spend 3 more points somewhere into this tree so we can get the next passive here, but it's whatever. Then Thick Skinned, also really good. Reduces damage taken from damage over time effects. And then these just reduce physical and magical damage. I boost these later on once these are pretty high, but you should always try to do it a little bit evenly. So don't just start with putting 72 points into this one and ignore the other. So just kind of try to get the best possible outcome, because for example, putting 10 points into this first gives way more than 10 points into this. You will just see the numbers, so that's why these are higher than the other ones. Yeah. Alright. And the green, yeah, Warlord is always really nice. Yeah, right now I just tried to get 75 here, I guess. It doesn't really make sense, so I kind of have to work it out. But yeah, Warlord and Sprinter are kind of nice, that's whatever. But the most important ones are Mooncalf and Tenacity. I mean, yeah, let's not use the numbers right here perfectly, because I'm not fully specced yet. It's just Mooncalf is the most important one. Tenacity is pretty important depending on your stamina regeneration. Since my stamina regeneration right now is so high, I don't really have to use heavy attacks, so I don't get that much from Tenacity. Yeah, here I kind of used some reduced block costs, reduced cost of roll dodge. I would like to spend these points more into the other trees, but then again, here I just wanted to get 75 points, which works out really nicely. As you can see, here's a clean 19%, 10.22 and 1%, and with this we unlock that treasure chests have better items in them, which is kind of nice. That's why I spent so many points there. Now in blue, I actually spent a lot of points into Master at Arms, then again 3 into Physical Weapon Expert to get the Butcher passive. So again, I wanted to have 75. Yeah, Butcher is really nice, increases damage done with light and heavy attacks by 5% to low life enemies. This is your main tree, this is where you want to start out really, in the blue tree. Thaumaturge increases damage done with the damage over time effects. Like almost, I think everything we do is damage over... Oh. Actually, I should... Yeah, sorry for that little interruption there. Of course, I should theoretically put more points into Master at Arms, because almost all of our skills are damage over time. But then again, I wanted to have these 75 points here, so that's kind of the decisions you have to make. What else is important? Mighty, like, actually piercing. The first thing you should actually boost is piercing. Increases your physical penetration, especially if you're still kind of leveling, still doing whatever. Soloing around. This will just increase your damage so much. Then Mighty. Of course, also increases your physical damage. Why not? One of the best things you can do. And I think lastly, Precise Strikes. Increases your critical damage. So you always need to kind of think when is it too much? Like, and if I would put these 20 points into Mighty here, like it goes up so slowly at that point. But if you start a fresh one, if you have very little points into some passive, look here for 20 points, I already get 9% more critical damage. And that's probably better than putting another 20 points into Mighty or Thaumaturge, because that will only give me like 3 or 4% more damage. Alright, that's it. So I guess now we do the obligatory dummy test. And as I said, usually I include some footage. But yeah, this time I'm sorry, I'm just too lazy to do another recording. You just have to take my word that I did run Feng Lair with this build. Alright, so kind of a rotation. I'm not a big fan of rotations, as I always said. Or at least I'm not a big fan of telling people that the damage sucks because of the rotation. Because if you're dealing 2000 damage per second as a DD, you have way more problems than your rotation. You kind of need to learn how to use skills and gear, like which skills to use, which gear to use, which passives, how to get your recoveries up, how to get your weapon damage up, and all that stuff. I kind of covered all of that in this build right here. I mean, we can talk about two of my jewelry enchantments are weapon damage. I guess that's kind of important to say. Also enchantments, like all the gear has stamina, except Head and Shoulders. If you're not champion level 300 yet and you lack some of the maximum health, you probably need to put more health on your armor or more health into your attributes. That doesn't really matter. Or you can also use food that gives... There's one type of food which gives 5000 health and a lot of stamina recovery, but no stamina, so you could also use this. This is probably your best bet. I guess if you're struggling with health and regeneration, just use the food that only gives health and recovery, then you're covered. You should always try to put weapon damage on your jewelry, and on the weapon enchantments, I'm actually not that sure. Just make sure that you don't have, for example, 2x poison damage on the... Or just make sure that all of the enchantments are different, because otherwise... only one counts, so if you have 2x disease damage, for example, only one of them will actually proc. So here I have disease damage, then this absorb stamina, there's probably a better choice, but I guess why not. Then poison damage instead of disease, right? And increase your weapon damage by 320%. So we have all of that covered, 4 different enchantments, that's where it's at. Using some poisons, probably even better. But I'm not I've made a big step of actually using crafted potions, which are quite expensive. All right, let's start. So yeah, you want to place all of your damage over times, obviously. And then just spam, and then you kind of rotate. So that's why it's called a rotation, and the rotation is not perfect. Yeah, as you can see, like, it doesn't really add up with the times. The Razor Caltrops runs out way before the other two damage over times there. But I guess it's okay. And for proper rotation, yeah, that's what I'm gonna do here. Yeah, you can just do some heavy attacks and while that's the case. So for example, now I can do a heavy attack and then, oh, whoops, activated one skill twice there. Oh my god. Yeah, sometimes I have a little bit of input lag, so that's why the rotation isn't always on point, sadly. I also forgot, like, always cast your ultimate, obviously, when it's ready, and always make sure that your major vitality is up. I think I'm just clicking also way too fast, so that's why sometimes I have problems activating skills, because I just click too fast. But this is not going to change over the course of this video, so let's just ignore it. Okay, there we go. Yeah, to be honest, the damage isn't that great, since I have, like, this cheetah set on. 27,000. I'm pretty sure... Let me see... Okay, so this is with the bow. There I have the 32,000, and... Oh, is this the same one? Alright. Oh. Okay, so this is exactly the same build, also with Arms of Reliquent. So here I did... I don't know, I fucked it up, but I think the... Yeah, the thing is, in a dungeon, I have way more... I actually have over-penetration because of the tank. And that's one of the reasons, and of course you have synergies and all of that stuff, but the exact same build in the dungeon I dealt 33,000 DPS to a boss. But I think I also have done more against the dummy, definitely. I'm not sure. But that's the kind of thing you can expect from this. Again, the build isn't fully, like, not all of the things are divine, not all of the armor. Not all of the things are golden, so you can probably reach 30,000 on the dummy, or even more. You should actually be able to reach more. I mean, then there's again, I don't even have the second set of the Spriggan's weapons here, I just have some random ass weapons. Yeah. One more thing before I forget it. You will want to use the Lovamondo stone. Except if you're over-penetrating, but this will only happen if you already have a lot of, yeah, champion points, basically. Or if you have sharpened weapons and all of that. So you kind of have to see that for yourself. Then you could use the warrior, or the thief, or the assassin, whatever. I still like the lover really much, especially in solo. Because in solo, I'm still far from the penetration cap. Alright guys, I hope you liked the video. It was pretty long this time. Like, what the hell? 45 minutes. Are you serious? Okay, anyway, let me know what you think. Let me know which parts I shouldn't talk about, because obviously this video is way too long. Or maybe you think this video was very well Very well then, because I talk about all of these things and nobody ever really explains them in the builds, because it's assumed that people know them. But if everyone assumes that people know this, then it could happen that people just miss all the information, like how you actually make a build. I actually thought about making a video about how to make a build, so that I explain exactly what stuff you have, like how you choose, should I go for the stamina recovery glyph or the weapon damage glyph? Like, how do you determine this? How do you determine which food to take? How do you determine how many points to put? Because you always see this, 64 into stamina, but that's not the only option you have. I mean, especially on tanks, but even on damage, you could put some points into health. Usually that just means you can use other food, or you can use different things on your armor, like how all of this comes together. But yeah, that's another topic. Let me know if you want to see something like this, how to make a build in general, what to look out for, which armor sets to use, and all of that stuff. But yeah, also let me know what you think about this video, about this build, if you think it sucks because you really have to use a bow or whatever. Anyway guys, see you next time. Thanks for watching.